I have been to Leuven, to Namur, to Liège, to all kinds of Brussels, to Bruges, to everywhere in Belgium, and finally I made it to the main place. So here I am, and thanks indeed to the founding institution here. UCSIA, S-I, was Santo Ignatius from Loyola. It's a pleasure indeed. When I got a letter at the end of January inviting me, I was curious, what are they going to ask me to talk about? Knowing a little bit about Antwerpen, I was guessing Israel-Palestine. No. Knowing a little bit about something that, you know, is quite important, and in Gazette van Antwerpen today, Verborgen Gebetsruine in Kelder Brussels Airport, Police duckt clandestine meetings, Muslims up. Schlechts enkelte maanden vor de Anslagen van 22 Mart, etc., etc. I was thinking that maybe relationship to Islam, Islamic State, and things of that kind would be interesting. Nothing of the kind. What you wanted was that I should talk about you. Not about anybody else. Not in the sense of Belgium, but in the sense of two very important topics, and I have been working on both of them. And topic number one, that's the one you suggested, is simply peace at the threat of nationalism in Europe. But you had a second topic in mind that I also could take, refugees, a challenge to social coherence and peace in Europe. In other words, about Europe, European Union. And when I'm given a choice, I have a typical mediator's tendency to say both and. So I'll talk about both. And I'll do it within the allotted time. It will be a little bit superficial, but not, you'll learn something new. I put on that one two things. The first one is, if you will, a very short formulation of about 60 years' work. It's a formula for peace. Four tasks. Equity multiplied by empathy, positive, divided by the threats to peace, trauma multiplied by conflict. Let me define the four. And definitions must be taken seriously. Equity means cooperation for mutual and equal benefit. Don't just say cooperation, the point is equal benefit. That leaves out neoliberalism and raw capitalism as a way of building peace. There is an element of mutual benefit, but certainly not equal. Empathy is related to harmony. Empathy meaning understanding the other as the other, as other understands him and herself. It does not mean agreeing or disagreeing, sympathy or antipathy. It simply means being inside the other. There is a particular profession that is a specialist on this, and I work with some of them and learn a lot. They're actors. Don't try psychology. That is seeing other from the outside and could very easily be an insult. The actors have to be that person. Now, this is essential for harmony. What is harmony? Harmony is feeling sorrow when other is sorrow, feeling the joy of other as a joy. Sharing sorrow, sharing joy, emotional resonance. So imagine now that you have two persons, and I'm so old-fashioned that I talk about man and woman when I talk about marriage. I'm that type. Two persons, and these two persons have managed their cooperation, often called partnership, for mutual and equal benefit, and at the same time a deep understanding of each other, knowing what makes for sadness and what makes for joy. But more than that, feeling the sadness of other and feeling the joy of other. If you have a little bit too little of one of them, you can compensate by more on the other, hence the multiplication sign. Sounds good. But there are two things lurking in the denominator of the fraction. Unreconciled trauma and unsolved conflict. Now, trauma are the residues of the violence of the past. Conflict is not violence, but could lead to it. Conflict means incompatibility. You want something, I also want something. It's incompatible. Two men, I want that woman. The other man says, I want that woman. They want exactly the same. Incompatible. Unless you take the French solution, ménage à trois. But I am now in Flemish part of Belgium, so I will of course not even think in such terms. But I can reveal to you that the French even have something for four persons. But again, these are French, you know how these people are. Now, having said that, conflict is in itself not violence, but it is incompatibility of goals. I want something, he wants something, they don't go together. I want something, I also want something else, they don't go together. Solution of conflict is to make them compatible. The bad way of solving a conflict, the lazy way, the way for unintelligent, uncreative people, is called compromise. You cut off half of your claim and I cut off half of mine and we can meet in the middle. That's intellectual laziness. No, the point about creativity is to say, is there something we can do with the context, bringing in some aspects of a new reality so that the goals become compatible? Ecuador wants a zone in the Andes. Peru is totally in agreement, they want exactly the same zone, 500 square kilometers. They have been fighting four wars since 1941 about where to draw the border. Drawing a border in a territory is compromise. Since 1941 to 1995, the ex-president of Ecuador asked me, what would you be your advice, Professor Galtung? How do we draw the border? And I said, Your Excellency, could you imagine not drawing any border at all, but administer the 500 square kilometers, or at least a part of it, as a two-state zone, maybe with a natural park. Zona Biestadal, Parque Natural. He said, Professor Galtung, very creative, but too creative. I have participated in these conferences about where to draw the border the last 30 years. Nobody has ever said this. This was in July 1995. In June 1998, I was called to Quito, Ecuador by the ambassador in Geneva. Could you come and talk with my bosses? And I said, you mean the foreign minister? You mean the prime minister? You mean the president? No, I said my bosses, the generals and the admirals. Foreign minister, prime minister, president, they come and go. Admirals and generals stay. I had 80 of them, no, 40 of them in front of me. They examined me for 8 hours. The 5th of June, 1998, in September, the treaty was signed. And Ecuador and Peru expressed their deep gratitude to the United States. That's okay. I'm used to that. Perfectly okay. This is not the professorial game of being quoted. This is the mediator game of being useful. United States had financed, through petrol companies, the government of Lima and the government of Ecuador to go to war against each other in 1941, and hadn't done anything. But it's a tradition in the Americas to thank the United States. Okay. We leave that theme, and I have now tried to say, how was I thinking? Well, I was thinking, they have to cooperate on something for mutual benefit and equal benefit. It's not enough to draw a line, they could cooperate. And they did it beautifully. They planted trees, and there are very few countries that go to war about which trees to plant. I haven't heard of anybody. But they developed it into an economic zone for the nearby farmers. It is blossoming. It's a fantastic success. And there are baby zones along that border because it was such a success in bringing farmers from both sides together. And the European Union made a road. How about empathy? Through cooperation, they started understanding the positions of each other. They started with hatred. They started with violence. 4 terrible wars. In the usual Latin American pattern, white generals and admirals talking perfect 17th century Spanish, sacrificing red-skinned Indians. The usual pattern. Thousands. After this peace treaty, there hasn't been a single act of violence. No act of revenge. They started understanding each other. I had said to them, when this starts working, maybe you go back to what happened, 1941. And maybe it might be a good idea with some reconciliation. It has not happened. The state that has to say, I'm so sorry about that, I wish I hadn't done it, is the United States of America. Well, they have intervened militarily in other countries 248 times since 1801. And since the Second World War, they have killed more than 20 million people in 37 countries. Very few Europeans know this. And I would assume that Belgium, as the home of the European Union and NATO, would be particularly good at rejecting such knowledge. You don't have to believe a word of what I say. I can just say, tell you this is the truth. It will seep into you sooner or later. It will seep into you. Often it is a little bit disagreeable. How about conflict? How do we solve a conflict? There are many of them, and they come every day. Incompatible goals. Mediation in one sense is very simple. It's based on 3 points. You talk with everybody. I find myself seated in a dark place in Afghanistan on the other side of the table as 3 Taliban. What do I ask them? I ask them, what does the Afghanistan look like where you would like to live? Then I ask them, what's the worst thing that happened to Afghanistan? And what's the best thing? I could have a handful of Belgians in front of me and ask the same question. Since yours is an African country, I'm not thinking now of Leopold I's genocide, the worst of all of them in the Congo. I'm not thinking of your lack of ability to take that seriously and understand before one day 1 million from Congo is knocking on your door. Might be interesting to take it seriously. I'm not thinking of that. I'm thinking of Belgium as the product of the manipulation by big neighboring powers. You are a constructed state from the outset. 1830s, you are put together and you have found the two basic points in the solution. Also for real African countries, not Belgium as African country. Federation inside, community outside. It's with deep regret I find, je constate, that you haven't found a space for the German part that you should. I find that sad, but let's leave that aside. Federation inside, confederation outside. That confederation is called the European Community. Started with Benelux, it added 3 more. Came through the French-German Accord of 9th of May 1950. And of course Italy was joining. The Community of Six started the 1st of January in the sense of entrée en vigueur, 1958, was a success. The Union of 28 is a failure. I'll come to that. So now I have tried to explain what these 4 terms stand for. And you now see in front of you a little scheme. The Latin Americans say una esquemita. A little mental scheme. DPT stands for diagnosis, prognosis, therapy. Another word for diagnosis is analysis. Another word for prognosis is forecasting. Another word for therapy is remedies. We have some people in the world called politicians. They often go straight to the therapy, to the solutions, without diagnosing. We have some people in the world very good at diagnosis, extremely afraid of forecasting, and being told by Max Weber, don't engage in politics. Wertfreiheit. They're called academics. I have some of them in front of me, and I'll meet more tomorrow. Where did I get the idea of DPT together? Well, I come from a medical family. When I was born, my uncle sent a cable to my father, the one who was in concentration camp, and was in concentration camp as a hostage for British bombing of Oslo. It was my task every morning to pick up the newspaper where the headline could be, Professor Galtung executed this morning at 5 o'clock. Well, if you do that, you see, for some time, you might draw the conclusion that Norway should have been 10 times more strong in order to prevent the Germans from coming. As a matter of fact, the Germans thought we were 3 times stronger than we were. and twice stronger than the wildest military budget, and they came. But we're leaving all that aside. The point about it is just the following. You could get that idea, or you could the idea that I got, which is simply the idea there's something wrong about war, and nobody has the right to take my beloved father from me. Okay. I'm called the father of peace studies, grandfather, great-grandfather, great-great-grandfather. I watch my offspring with interest. Some are doing very well, and the general movement is in the correct direction. Peace by peaceful means. Peace by peaceful means. So we have DPT trying to integrate them. You will find at universities that medical people, physicians, it's taken for obvious that they should do that. Architects, engineers, the same. Sociologists are told to stay off. Same with political scientists. Economists have to do it secretly as secret and well-paid consultants. What happens to psychologists? Well, they dress themselves up as psychoanalysts and psychiatrists and get some kind of medical certificate to do DPT. I know a little bit about all of these ways of thinking. It's all in your mind, you see, how you think about it. If you think therapy-free thoughts, you will have an other diagnosis than if you also are thinking of solutions. And as Mark Twain said, if your only tool is a hammer, if your only therapy is bang, 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 the world looks like a nail. It could be that the therapy you believe in will shape your diagnosis. I say that as a warning also to myself. Having said this, I now have two topics on the list. One is called nationalism, and the other one is called not refugees, it is much more than that, it's migration. What's going on is not asylum seekers and refugees, that's a small part of it. It's a Völkerwanderung, Völkerwanderung. My estimate some years ago is that it will last at least 50 years, and we are talking about at least 50 million. It's probably too low. And I have said, you may have a handful of Congolese knocking on your door one day. And they may know more about Leopold I than you do. I just say that. So now, as you will see from that little skip, I now have exactly six things to say. What is my diagnosis for the parties? The right-wing parties. I'll not describe them. We are thinking of Le Pen, père et fille, the daughter being more gifted than the father. No doubt about that. Why? What has happened? What has happened to the European Union where wars are unthinkable? I think you have to go back to year 395. Which was confirmed in 1054. I could, of course, be a little bit vicious and ask how many people in this room know what I'm talking about. And I can just tell you, if you want to understand Europe, you have no chance without 395 and 1054. And there is a second point. You have no chance without the difference between direct and structural violence. In 395, the Roman Empire was divided into two parts. The Catholic became the West Roman, and the Orthodox became the East Roman. The border was drawn in a way which was more or less confirmed when they banned each other mutually. The line was drawn, and the line is almost the same today. Catholic means universal, Orthodox means the correct faith. Not very modest names for themselves. Something extremely dramatic happened a couple of weeks ago. Pope Francis, a Jesuit, incidentally, and a Franciscan in the sense of Santo Francesco, not in the sense of what the Franciscan order became later. I could also say that maybe Pope Francis is the Jesuit of the Jesuits, doing to the Jesuits what the Jesuit, what Ignatius, was hoping to do to the Vatican. So I'm just, you know, entering into territory where angels fear to tread, but since I'm not an angel, I go into that one. So having said that, he met with Kirill, the patriarch of the Orthodox. Of all places in the world, at the airport of Havana, Cuba. I mean, if anybody should try to guess where would they meet? I'm quite good at prognosis, but I wouldn't make that one. But it was due to two brothers, Fidel and Ramon. Ramon being Catholic, Fidel being, of course, the more important of the two. Two brothers, the sons of a poor land worker from Galicia in Spain, a gallego, who became rich in Cuba. The rest of the story you know. Two brothers bringing together two civilizations, trying to heal the fault line in Europe. That is a major reason why Europe is today not united. The Orthodox part and the Catholic part. Greece is mainly Orthodox. Be aware of that. Now the Catholic part, in Catholic part you have Italy. The Italian economic crimes and failure to comply with European Union rules are worse than what Greece did. To understand by Mr. Schäuble, the finance minister, not of Germany, of the European Union, de facto. But he picked on Greece again and again in a tradition of pure German racism. It has to do with what happened in 395. Schäuble doesn't know this. He is the victim of the shadows of history. If you want to do something in this field, peace and violence, you have to know some history. But I noticed that there is another thing going on. Yes, they created a Europe of 6, of 8, of 10, 12, of 15, 28. At least for the 6, the 10 and the 12, war is unthinkable. What was not unthinkable, because they didn't think it, was structural violence, flagrant inequality and exploitation. The European Union as a pyramid with Germany on top. Northern Nordic Protestant countries, including Netherlands, maybe half of Belgium, maybe that, close nearby, at the bottom, the Latin countries. Among the Latin countries, France, that was used to see itself at the top. La communauté européenne pensée par les Français, payée par les Allemands, was the general idea. And the German idiots were willing to pay any amount if they could be accepted by Mother Europe. And enter im Schloss. You see, we are dealing here with very basic points. And the point I'm making is that Europe, for lack of understanding that inequality could be an other word for war, and that inequality works through structural violence, through exploitation, penetration, segmentation, marginalization, fragmentation. It's a complicated recipe. rejected. And there is nowhere in the world where there are so many talented professors who have rejected my theory of structural violence as in Germany. Okay, my dear friends, liebe akademische deutsche Freunde, I happen to have some vicious assistants who are investigating how much income you have. It is not representative for the European Union. Could there be a relationship between the concepts you pick up and where you stand socially? Of course there is. Obvious. For that reason, one says in German, man merkt an Absicht und wird verstimmt. One understands the tension between the concept of structural violence and one doesn't like it. That's your right. You may reject it, but maybe at your own costs. We are approaching, as a prognosis, a revolt in the European Union of the Latin countries against the non-Latin. We are approaching that. It is quite sure that this will not be only a question of some economic tricks at the top. Be aware of the fact that Brussels is unable to inspire enthusiasm. I'm enthusiastic about the European community as a bulwark against war. If you look at it today, the major countries, you take the strongest one, European, Germany, France, Italy, Spain, you have 5 countries. You have 10 bilateral relations. If you know your history, you will be able to identify the wars in all bilateral relations. England and France lasted 400 years, to take an example. To construct out of 800 years of warfare a community where peace is obvious and war is almost unthinkable. Fantastic. And who did it? Well, 2 Frenchmen. And they had a brilliant formula. Nazi Germany has been so atrocious that it has to become a member of the family. The only problem was that there was no family. There was only an alliance. It's not the same. You cannot go to bed with somebody with guns. It's not the way to do it. In other words, they had to construct something. And what they construct something was, of course, the union of Stahl and Kohl, steel and coal, which become Mitterrand and Kohl. And stupidly argued, because today you don't make war necessarily with steel and coal. You make it with ABC, and there are different ways of doing it. You can do it by hacking. There are very many ways of doing it. But anyhow, something came out of it. They came to institution building. They did not manage step 4 in positive peace. Number 1 is equity, number 2 is empathy, number 3 is institution, number 4 is fusion. One actor called Europe. They didn't manage that one. And with the structural pyramid, they will not manage it. The obvious remedy is for Latin America to produce their own Volkswagen, only do it better. Simply stop buying German goods. Stop it. If these are the conditions under which it is done. It's for Germany to step down from its position. There are those in Germany who fear that and think they can do better without European Union. Most of them don't think that. For that reason, AfD is a relatively small group still. In France, it is growing. In the other countries, it will grow and grow and grow. And I have given two parts in my diagnosis. What else can be done? Well, step back a little bit in the history of the European Union. There are two steps that the European Union might consider, but I agree completely with the president of the European Parliament, a German, who says, communicate your faith in the European Union. Don't just communicate your technocracy, your bureaucracy, and whatever kind of secret plans you're making. Problem is whether these people have any faith in anything, or whether it is only a technocratic kind of ding and ding an sich. But there are two things that immediately stand out. Instead of a single currency, a common currency. Leaving for the member states a major instrument for financial health, revaluation, devaluation, and so on. But the common currency. Most deals will still be in the euro. The people who will make enormous amount of money on this will be the people who produce cash registers, because they have to be twice as big for the local currency from the euro. And the rates may fluctuate. It's not the end of the world. I think they made a mistake. They should have go to single currency via common currency. And they had it as the acquis. The acquis was common, it was not single. They took too big a step. They were too absolutist, too fundamentalist, too extremist, too fanatical. All the opposite of pragmatic, which one often associates with the West in general. One should almost believe that they were terrorists or something of the kind, with their fundamentalism. Second point, also important, you might consider different degrees of membership. It has been mentioned before. You have been mentioning different speeds. Nothing wrong about that. Moving a little bit slowly. Maybe some countries are not quite ripe for it yet. Because if you want to constitute a European community and union, you have to understand that you have to cooperate with equity, and you have to establish harmony with empathy. If you are a German, what happens at the end of Greece will hit your heart. Not only appeal to your racism. Now, take some steps back and then move forward again. Don't give up the euro. Don't give up the open zones. The border, I just passed one of it, being driven by my beloved friend, Professor Kees van der Veer, who is sitting here, emeritus, from the Vrije Universiteit, Amsterdam, and his wife Leila from Finland, with my Japanese wife, Shmiko Nishimura. So, zoop, through the border. Can we do that? Well, depends on the second column. The second column has to do with migration. Why do they migrate? How far back in time do we have to go? I will recommend to go back to the 4th of May, 1493. Everybody knows the Tratado of the Tordesillas from 1494, where the Pope divided the world in two and distributed it between two criminals. One was called Spain, the other one was called Portugal. Now, to distribute the world between two thieves, I am not quite sure I will call a peace treaty. I'm not quite sure. I'm just trying to talk realistically about it. But much more important, no comparison, is the 4th of May, 1493. So here I'm testing your historical knowledge. You are brilliant. You are from a very famous town in a very famous country. Bolla Papale, our Pope Alexander VI from Valencia. And he said, us is given, us being the plural for himself. The lands, the mainlands, and the islands discovered by our beloved son, Cristoforo Colombo, Cristo Colon, depends on which language you talk, and so on. And then he goes on saying that we, meaning himself, he actually became a pope because he was supported by the male part of the Catholic kings. So he gave it back. We will give all of this with full jurisdiction to the Reyes Catholicos, to Isabel and Ferdinand, with full jurisdiction. I have been told that the inhabitants are very peaceful, walk almost naked, and don't eat meat. Columbus had told him that, and Columbus drew the conclusion they will become excellent slaves. Because Columbus didn't have the category different and equal. He had only the category equal, different up, dangerous, different down, to be dominated. His mind was structured that way. Depends on how your mind is structured. And I have given you two small things on that sheet to put something new into your mind. You didn't think of that before you came here. So now I go on. Where do I go? Well, I go to the idea of colonizing the world. If you colonize the whole world with the mandate from God through we, Papa, Alejandro VI, or Alejandro VI, Alessandro VI in Italiano, and you publish it as a bolla papale, as a papal bull, don't be surprised that in the 16th century, we are at the end of the 15th, you have already killed your first 20 million. And you go on killing and killing and killing. Was there anything similar in the Orthodox Church? No. They didn't. Dictatorship? Yes. Ivan the Terrible? Yes. As possibly one model for Stalin. But Stalin got most of his idea from the Orthodox Church in the sense of don't talk, sing and pray with incense and music and ceremony. He got also quite a lot of idea from the Bible. There are 400 massacres in the Bible, 100 by God. He seems to be quite strict, this God. I myself do not believe in him. I have nothing against Jesus Christ. I love him. Mary the Mother, I'm in love with her. But I've been told that he's a permanent virgin, so there's nothing that can be done about it. I have very serious arguments when it comes to the Father and the Holy Spirit. But my theology is not what you are interested in. I would rather say, what do we do? Well, be aware of the fact that we have made, we from the West, inspired by that Pope, big parts of the world uninhabitable. And we have used four major mechanisms. Colonialism, slavery, robbery capitalism, robbing raw materials, processing them, pocketing the value added for your own pockets, not for theirs, cultivating a little elite that can buy your processed goods, cultivating them, 1%, 2%, and wars. Not saying they haven't made some wars themselves, but they are mainly inspired by us. Now, with these four instruments, we have managed to make big parts of the world uninhabitable. Is it strange if they are moving? Okay, I'm sitting with Taliban in Afghanistan. What do they tell me? They tell me the basic point that happened. If you want to understand Afghanistan, you have to start in 1893 with the Durand Line. D-U-R-A-N-D. And you can now check your history textbooks and find out how little you have learned about the Durand Line. You can check your politicians and find out whether they know what that was. A British imperialist who was the Secretary of State for the Viceroyalty called India, the jewel in the British Empire, decided to draw a line between the British Empire and Afghanistan, 4,000 kilometers, cutting through the Pashtun in two parts. The biggest nation in the world without a state, 50 million. The second biggest are the Kurds, also divided by us, mainly. Cutting it, and now in addition doing what Americans like to do, building a fence. Well, whenever you have a fence, you have tunnels, so it will stimulate tunnel digging. It's madness. What's the solution? A Central Asian community of Afghanistan and Pakistan imitating, learning from the mother of communities, the European community. But they use the word community thinking of six rather than 28. Now, this was a little excursion. What is now the big point here? Well, if you make it uninhabitable, then you have to do what I do. You have to talk with them. Like you sit talking with Taliban in Afghanistan, you sit talking with Al-Qaeda in various countries, you even talk with people in Pentagon and State Department. You can even go as far as to Brussels, where you find a lot of crazy, ignorant people. Now, having said that, what do you talk about in this particular case? Well, they tell me it is uninhabitable. And they more or less give it the same rest. Slavery, colonialism, robbery, capitalism, wars. You don't understand it if you only focus on the war in Syria. That's a very small part of the whole thing. But it is important, not neglecting it. So some of them say, we are coming. And some of them say, we were told that the colonial countries were mother countries, and we are searching motherly love. Now, to go to Paris and London in search of motherly love from Paris and London, do they believe it? Well, some of the naive believe it. The motherly love is not exactly a good metaphor. So what I find is the way they think is the following. You came to us totally uninvited. You cut up our continent, you drew lines, you put together those who didn't want to be together. Maybe Flemish, Germans and Wallon. And you cut them off from their neighbors with whom they wanted to be together. But I have said that Belgium is doing just fine, except for the German part. You did that. You created a catastrophe. That catastrophe has been going on and on and on for hundreds of years. There is only one single country of you, of the 11 colonial states in the European Union. There is only one of the 11 that has apologized. Silvio Berlusconi from Italy is the only one. They love him. Now, many of us don't love Silvio Berlusconi. Did he do it because he wanted a good oil contract? Well, nobody is saying that he had only one motivation, but he knew that what happened in 1911 was one of the biggest crimes in humanity. It was Italian bombers instructed by French and Americans killing mothers, old people, children in oases. In a country where the oases are the free territory and men fight on horse in the desert. An unspeakable crime. In 2011 came the apology. You understand what I am thinking in connection with Belgium. You have to prepare yourself well. There, I've been working on that. I've been working in the German Ministry of Foreign Affairs. I've been working with the Herero, against whom in 1904 the German Prussian army committed suicide, genocide, not only by killing the males, but by poisoning the wells in order to kill mothers and children. The German Foreign Ministry made a horribly bad job. There's still no reconciliation. It can be done. But you have to go to the past and you have to understand what happened. You have to invite them, you have to have historical commissions, you have to say that, well, we also had some good intentions. There were some good intentions. No doubt about that. But you have to go into it. So let me now summarize, coming to an end. I have talked a lot, but I'm doing not too badly in terms of time. This is a room without a clock. It's a beautiful room. It is lofty, literally speaking. It points upwards towards therapy or towards the place from which I like to see the world. I talk about my intellectual helicopter. You have to go up a little bit, you see. See it from above, see the shadows, see the Durand line, to use a good American expression, fucking up Central Asia completely. To see the lines that have been drawn, the 395,054 line, making a catastrophe of the European continent. And what happened was, of course, that the Catholics expanded through the German Templar Knights, the Templar Knights, going eastward into Poland, Catholicizing Poland, Lithuania, Latvia, not Estonia, became Protestant, going into Ukraine. Going into Ukraine till they stopped. The Orthodox were too strong. What does the word Ukraina mean in Russian? U means at, and Kraina means the border, the country at the border. A very accurate name. Two Western European psychopaths, one called Napoleon and the other called Hitler, filled with an enormous amount of self-admiration, narcissism, and paranoia. The two basic characteristics of psychopathy, or the psychopath, attacked Russia. Russia never attacked them. Yes, for some period they occupied part of Eastern Europe. They did. They made basic mistakes in Poland. They occupied the Nazi allies of Nazi Germany. Sooner or later, they came to the conclusion that it's unlikely to be repeated. Okay, I'm just saying it. We've had an enormous push. And I think the basic motivation for Hitler to attack Soviet Union was to beat Napoleon. Napoleon didn't make it, I'll make it. Wahnsinn, großen Wahnsinn. Okay. I have tried to see it from above, and I have said there are things that can be done. But be so kind, look at the history, look at the past, and then try to be realistic and jump into it. Ask yourself, how does it feel to be a country constructed by big powers? How does that feel? Well, you know something about it. You are the European experts on being an African country. Make use of it. Thank you. And now only say one little thing. I will not conceal that I have 10 books about what I thought you would be interested in, namely what peace studies are about. It's only 10 euros. And once when I was talking in Tel Aviv, one of my 40 visits to the Middle East, being able to achieve absolutely nothing, but I'm not the only one, absolutely nothing. And I presented a peace plan, Israel-Palestine, called 1-2-6-20. Palestine fully recognized. A two-state solution in the middle. A six-state community of Israel with the five border countries, Arab. And a 20-state community for security and cooperation of the neighbors of the neighbors and their neighbors. It's about 20. Up to me came a guy and said, Professor Galtung, I don't like your peace plan. I don't like it at all. Now, I knew exactly what he liked. He wanted more expansion. And he wanted expansion to the Nile and the Euphrates. He wanted Genesis 15, 18. But he said something that I was very grateful for. I'll buy one of your books if you sign it, because your signature may be worth something. I have the pen, and here are 10 books, 10 euros for each. Thank you so much.
That's for after the questions. So thanks for the helpful view. Who wants to find the first question to Professor Johan Galtung? The opportunity.
I may need somebody to tell me what the question was. But go ahead, please, whatever you want. Doesn't have to be a question, could also be a strongly disagree or whatever.
I would like to ask you, you've been pursuing peace for...
Could you come a little bit closer to me? No, yeah, well, yeah, yeah, okay.
You've been pursuing peace for many, many decades. I'm somewhat younger than you are. Looking back, how are things going compared to how they were when you started out this road of trying to promote peace?
Okay. It's a very good question. We in Transcend, which is the name of the mediation organization, Transcend means go beyond. We think we have had 35 successes. I mention only one of them, Ecuador-Peru. We did quite a lot of good work during the Cold War. Quite a lot. In five countries. Became very soon very clear that the major country was Finland. And in 1967, I had a very simple little idea. I had been interviewing the heads of the political section of the foreign ministries in 19 countries between Washington and Moscow, including Brussels, NATO, Warsaw Pact, non-aligned. And they said, the thing that really works is the United Nations Economic Commission for Europe. And the worst problem is security. We have not been able to solve it. We are pointing at each other with nuclear-tipped missiles. So I put two and two together and came up with an idea in 1967. United Nations Security Commission for Europe. I was given genius certificate for having put in the word security. I just put 2 + 2 together and got something close to 4. I had been doing that study for Council of Europe. And my report was presented by a right-wing Gaullist. And since you understand French, I'll quote him in French. Monsieur Dame, nous avons ici un certain Monsieur Galtung. Il a dit qu'il faut s'asseoir avec les communistes puis dialoguer. Monsieur Dame, je vous propose que celui qui dit ça est lui-même un communiste. I was sitting on the gallery and okay, I could be malicious and say he's no longer alive and I'm in good shape. Finland was the country that took the idea. Finland. And they organized the Conference for Security and Cooperation in Europe. I was a behind the scene advisor. And in 1974, the president of Finland, Urho Kekkonen, and I got an honorary doctorate at the University of Tampere, the Peace University in Finland, for the job. So, am I now making too much out of myself? Look, what I am saying is this. We who are working in this field, we play a role. We project a vision, we have an image, we project it on the wall. Our role is neither 0% or 100%. It's somewhere in between. Let us say, I can bargain for 16.7 or something like that. But we play a role. So for that reason, if you want to contribute to peace, have a good idea what it could look like in a concrete situation. I mentioned two Frenchmen, their names are very famous, who had a damn good idea. I'm now taking the second part of what you say. How is it actually going? It is partly going not too badly at all. We have a lot of cooperation. It is for mutual benefit, and it could be much better if the benefit was equal. When Norway came out of the war very badly hit and Sweden had survived very well, Sweden could have bought fish for nothing from us in return for Volvo cars. Sweden had a very intelligent Minister of Finance with the name Gunnar Myrdal, who said, we are not going to do that. We are going to stimulate high-level technology in Norway by stimulating machine tool factories in Norway in return for Volvo cars. Equal for equal. Brilliant. Brilliant. They could have done it with fish and Volvo cars, and the daughters of fishery barons marrying Volvo managers. The usual pattern. And Swedish seeping into Norway. I didn't do that. So there is a lot of cooperation. There is a lot of understanding that if I hit you, I also hit myself. That is spreading. But it is spreading particularly well in some particular areas. Area number one, no doubt about it, Nordic Union. Area number two, Association of Southeast Asian Nations. Area number three, the original European Community. They went too far. They tried to overcome cleavages that they didn't even understand because they didn't know history. And they substituted for direct violence, structural violence, as I've indicated. But still I stand by the six. I might be generous, say 8, 10, 12. I stand by that. Absolutely. So having said that, we have some parts of the world where they, I would say, satisfy the formula. And in the Nordic countries, we have had historical commissions going back to the sore points and coming up with forms of understanding that are palatable, if you will. Where do we have the danger zones? If you do a little study, you look at the last 1,000 years of history using a book called Encyclopedia of War by George Cohen. And you simply take all the wars, there are many of them, in the last 1,000 years, you take note of who participated, for whatever reason. Just simply a tendency to be involved in war, for whatever reason. They will all say they have been provoked and attacked, they're all good at saying such things. But some are involved and some are not. You add it up and you divide by the number of years that state has existed. Number one, United States of America. Number two, Israel. Number three, England. Number four, Turkey. What happened to our good old friends, Germany, Italy, and Japan? They were considered our enemies from the so-called free democratic Western Europe in a certain period. By and large, they've had a very peaceful life with others. Japan is the only country in East Asia that has been fighting Western colonizers. China did practically speaking nothing, it was only colonized. Japan was fighting one after the other. Not strange that you get an atom bomb or two, and that you get the Tokyo Tribunal. But I'll not open that, I'll just indicate another way of looking at it, which you see not only because you have a helicopter, but also because you have a very well-informed Japanese wife. And I'm not saying that she is in any way a Japanese nationalist, not at all, she only knows more. So maybe we have a tendency to see only one angle, and maybe we need more perspectives. But the general movement is in a good direction. The general movement. I am saying that if we could reduce the warfare of United States of America, Israel, and England, it would help a lot. For England, it's very easy. They will follow United States. But United States and Israel were chosen by God. And if you are chosen by God, you are so close that there's not even space for United Nations Charter in between. United Kingdom has only been chosen by United States. It's like the moon relative to the sun. Not the same kind of thing. So I would not take United Kingdom very seriously. But if we could, and the way I do it is to propose alternatives that are alternatives that are alternatives that are ways of. So, quick question, long answer, but such is life.
More questions.
More.
Thank you.
Can you come a little bit closer to me, if that's possible? Sorry.
Imagine this audience is the General Assembly of the United Nations. What's your experience with this high level?
Abolish the Security Council as it is today. So here you have four concrete things I'm going to say. The one we have today has 15 members, five of them have veto powers. When I say abolish it as we have it today, I mean abolish the veto powers. Doesn't belong in any kind of democratic world. There is no such thing. Abolish Article 12A, which says that the General Assembly cannot pass any resolution if the issue is for the Security Council. That means the Security Council can have one member who puts it on the Security Council and the General Assembly is paralyzed. Abolish 12A. Expand the Security Council to 54 members. Why 54? Because the Economic and Social Council has 54 members and they administer United Nations Development Program, which is by and large a success. The Security Council has in its hands the security program, which is by and large a failure. Get 54 members representing all parts of the world so that things can be articulated. But keep the General Assembly for uniting for peace resolutions when the Security Council doesn't work. You had one a couple of years ago, and the resolution was to recognize Israel as a non-member observer state.
Palestine.
Thank you for me. Sometimes one makes a slip. Israel has been, I would say, over-recognized, but anyhow, since it breaks all the resolutions. We might consider actually saying to Israel, maybe we could have a cooling off period, 5 years without the United Nations, till you make up your mind to follow some of the resolutions. Thank you, Fumi. Together with the Vatican and the ambassador, the Palestinian, the United Nations, when he was speaking, had the Palestinian flag on top of United Nations. United States and Israel extremely angry, and there will be more things happening. This is the line that will be followed. By the latest 2025, I think that problem will be solved. I'll not go into that one. But I'm just saying, this is point one. Point two, have a United Nations People's Assembly, corresponding to the European Parliament, with direct elections from all member states. And those elections have to be fair and free elections. If it can operate in the Indian Union, in the European Union with 450 million inhabitants, in the Indian Union with 1150, and the participation rate could be higher in the European Union. We know all of that, but it is operating. It can operate in the world. Can operate in the world, and then you see for your inner eye that they would have the right to elect one representative for each million. Five Norwegians, okay. Nine Swedes, couple too many, but okay, let's take it. We can live with it. 315 Americans. 1,150 Indians, 1,350 Chinese, and all the saints come marching in. Now, the condition is fair and free elections. I happen to know a little bit about China, and my impression is that they are willing to have those fair and free elections for a United Nations World Assembly. They're not willing to have it for China. And that has to do with quite complicated things in Taoist philosophy that I'm not going to. They call our democracy arithmetic democracy. And they are of the opinion that due to the Confucius pattern of petition, they have idea democracy. But let's leave that aside. That was number two. Number three, and very important, is to get out of Manhattan. I don't think we would like to have the United Nations in, let us say, a quite extremist Arab country. Manhattan is very, very, very Jewish American. They are now changing. United States is responsible, is the most belligerent country in world history. It passed the Roman Empire in the beginning of the 1990s. It's not a healthy environment. Take another one. My recommendation is Hong Kong. There is empty real estate. In addition to that, they speak not only English, but even more important, they write at least Mandarin, and they speak Chinese dialect. Now, That's important. And number four, I have to say a word about peacekeeping. Do it with defensive weapons, short-range weapons. Learn police techniques, not only what is up and down on the gun. Learn to stand, maybe with a pistol, exuding authority, exercising crowd control. Learn non-violent techniques of how to handle violent people, surrounding them by 20 non-violent, for instance. Learn how to do it. Learn mediation, some basic mediation. What do you say if you are on a mission in old Yugoslavia and you are sitting in a room with a Croat there, a Serb there, and a Bosniak or another Muslim there? How do you open a conversation? Learn the minimum of that. Let 50% of you be women. And last point, be so numerous. Forget about blue helmets, we are talking about blue caps now, not helmets, that's too military. So numerous that it becomes a blue carpet. I know from the 38th floor in the United Nations, where decisions are made, that the thinking is in this direction. It's moving in that direction, and they're making experiments. And they're shocked by what often happens. Do that, and you will get peacekeeping. Do that with the Islamic State today, with the police, the clandestines, meetings, Muslims up. Gazette van Antwerpen. Do that. And you will suddenly find that the way to handle that problem is to parachute down troops and short-range weapons to protect the parts threatened by the Islamic State and its brutality, caused by us. Caused by us. But whoever caused it, brutal it is, kill one of them and you get 10 new ones tomorrow. Defend the threatened places. Effectively, defensive defense, and you might be able to start negotiations. In those negotiations, the West has to admit a couple of things. We are dealing with very self-righteous parts, England and France being extremely self-righteous, Germany compensating for its period of atrocity by being extremely humble, and now seems to be creeping out of the humility. Okay, these are all problems that can be handled, and I have tried to answer your question with very concrete things. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm interested more about your personal approach during a mediation or when you're asked for a peace intervention. Do you position yourself as a guide in the process or as their guest? So do you take the lead or do you let them take the lead of the process?
Can you just repeat it? Just to me without the microphone?
Yeah.
And just the essence of the last point.
For a mediation, when you are invited, do you see yourself as a guest who is invited?
As a guest?
Yeah. Or as the guide, the one who takes the initiative and who leads?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Thank you.
I got it. Very important. I'm usually invited. But I'm usually not invited by the parties to the conflict, but by some in between. You see, to be invited by one party is problematic. And I would never, never accept travel paid or hotel paid by anybody. Never. But there are lots of in-betweens in this world. So let's just take an example. Let's take Nepal. A lot of say that there are two parties, the Maoists and the Royalists. I was invited by the Nepal Human Rights Commission. And they organized the whole thing. One intensive week with 14 hours dialogue every day. Usually, by and large, every second time a Royalist, then a Maoist, and then a couple of in-between categories, or neither one nor the other categories. And there is no doubt that at the end of the week, I knew much more about Nepal than the president, the prime minister, and the king, and people of that kind. Because they have never asked questions. And when you mediate, you ask questions all the time. Every sentence you say ends with a question mark and raising the tone of your voice. And what you get in response is usually with an exclamation sign. And then comes the turning point where this and that party starts asking questions. And as you will understand, I work with only one party at a time. When one can sense a possible solution. And the best would of course be if the parties could arrive at it themselves. They usually don't. Partly because they hate each other too much and have become specialists at hurting each other. Partly because they don't know enough about solutions. And we who are working in mediation, we can of course be thinking, this reminds me of that and that and that and that. Maybe we could use this and this and that and that. A mediator has to be a working assembly of possible solutions. How to have 500 good solution studies stored in his and her mind. He then very modestly throws it back to them, gets reaction, and one frequent reaction is, interesting. I can live with that, but that one will never accept it. And I am then often in the position to say, it so happens that I come from that one who says he can live with it, but that you will never accept it. I've experienced that one quite often. You see, the road to peace passes through compelling visions, visions that are well made. But to develop those visions, you have to know the arguments of all sides. And I have in my, I started in 1958, so I'm closing in on 60 years, let us say 55 years. I haven't talked with one single party who hasn't had at least one good idea, one acceptable point of view. You just have to ask and ask and you get it. I hope that answered your question, more or less.
But during your talk, you've been switching quite a lot between interpersonal psychology and interactions between societies or states.
Could you come a little bit closer to me? You see, my talking is better than my hearing. I just simply...
Normally my voice is very...
Just a second, just come closer, yeah.
So, for example, also during your example, when you were talking to the Afghans, you sounded really like a psychotherapist, right? So how much do you think are the mechanisms that govern interpersonal psychology also apply to interactions between larger societies and states?
The personal psychology, particularly leaders, matters, but not that much. You see, There's a lot of personal psychology at work in Afghanistan. And there is, of course, a lot of ambition. And there are many people who hope to be the one who can say, I solved it. Well, if they say, I solved it, I have already made a mistake. There is no such thing. The parties have to solve it. It has to somehow come as a meeting place between parties. And for that reason, there is nothing called conflict management. And I myself, my tendency is to try to go around those leaders with strong egos and talk to somebody with whom it's possible to talk. It's not always possible, and don't believe that that leader with a strong ego necessarily is a dictator. He could be a president of the United States or Israel, and could be prime minister of UK. Could very easily be. And he internalizes the size of his own country and the importance of his own country as the importance of his ego. You somehow have to get around it. Now you also have to talk with us. You also have to do. It's very, very clear. And I have been sitting many times with such people across the table. And I never give names. I could say in a sense they are my clients. I could also say they are my patients. I could say that. But I can tell you that I had a president of a small country in Europe collapsing during the session, embracing me and crying on my shoulder. What will happen to my people? I embraced him and started patting him, which is not usually happening in mediation. The usual response I get when I start formulating as a question, you see, I have then asked myself, this conflict, what does it remind me of? And since I have been through quite a lot, I can say, let me take the thing that worked in that one and let me play it out. And the answer is, the most stupid thing I've ever heard. Now that's a very good answer. I tell you the answer I'm afraid of. Thank you, Professor Galtung, for visiting us again. I hope you'll come back next year too. That's the worst one. To say the most stupid thing I ever heard, excellent. I love you. Because then I can say, will you be so kind to spell out a little bit why it is, how it is stupid? Why it is stupid would be because I am stupid, since I've said it. But how it is stupid is what I want to know. It's obvious. And then I say, I'm a little bit slow. Well, and then he starts, you see. And then we can start getting into questions. And what happens can be summarized in one sentence. He knows much more about his conflict than I do. And I know much more about conflict. And conflicts in plural. So dialogue on equal terms. And when it works out well, he contributes his detailed knowledge and I my general perspectives. And I mentioned 35 times it has worked quite well. You have to have a little tiny bit of good nerves when you get all the nasty things said about you. That's okay. That's okay. You never reciprocate. You keep your voice quiet. You remember to ask questions. You may be tempted when he has a political argument to respond with a political argument, but you can respond with a question. Imagine you go to war and you win. Imagine that, that's what you want. We'll beat them. We are made of a different stuff than these cupboards are made of. Okay. you bid. What will happen then? And after about 5 minutes, he understands that maybe they will take revenge. Maybe that will come in 5 months, 5 years, 50 years, 500 years, but it will come. Because it has become their trauma. So when you build your glory on their trauma, you may be in a difficult situation in the future. So I just indicate to you ways in which these kind of talks develop. Now, if I have tried 150 times and have had, this is ridiculous figures, but 35 successes, you can then say, aha, you have had 115 failures. Intellectuals love to hear more about that. They love failures. Politicians like successes. How did you do it? How were you seated? What kind of a room was it? How did you talk to each other? Did you have drinks or not drinks? I say, be careful with drinks. Be careful, be careful, be careful. Carbonated water may be okay. Maybe some juices, but be careful about the choice. Be neutrally dressed, neutral, neutral, neutral. Don't exaggerate with new age incense and soft Indian music in the room. Don't do things like that, please. I mean, if you are negotiating with new age people, for heaven's sake, overload them with incense and new age music. But not in general. Neutral, neutral, neutral. Soft voice.